Hey guys, welcome back to the shop. As most of you probably already know, we've spent a lot of time this spring updating the main floor of our house. So let's take a look at some of the latest changes. So about a year ago already, we took out a very pointless wall that was blocking the entrance to the main door of the house. And then about Christmas time, we took out a huge wall between the hallway and the dining room. And then we also widened a couple of doorways that were just sort of choke points for no reason. And all of this left us with a bunch of holes in our hardwood flooring that was underneath the nasty carpet that we ripped out. So there's various stages of quality, from pretty rotten to actually quite good. But in order for the whole floor to look the same, we have to refinish the whole thing. And with all these holes in the floors, we have to patch it in first, sand it, refinish it. And so that's a big part of this project that I'm not doing. I just didn't feel like I would get as good a product trying to learn it on my own as I could get from paying somebody to do it for me, who's done this over and over and over again, and who's very good at it. And by the time I was done renting machines and buying parts and whatnot, it would have cost about the same anyway. So a big part of this project is getting the floors fixed. But before we can have that done, I've got to rip out all the old doors, and there's some old built-in closet fixtures that I got to get out of the way, because we want to have hardwood, it's red oak, we want to have that added into these closet spaces too that don't have any floors in them yet. So I've got to rip a bunch of stuff out and make ready for the flooring guy to show up. So here's a little tip that I'm trying out. I'm just running a screw through the old door and into the door jamb. That way, when I cut the door jamb free from the studs, the door doesn't get all floppy and want to bang around when I get it loose and try to take it outside. Then to rip an old door out is really simple. You just take a reciprocating saw with a long blade and run the blade between the door jamb and the stud in the wall that it's attached to. You just run it right through all the screws and nails and shims and whatever else is in the way, and top to bottom, T to B, you're pretty much ready to go real quick. In this case, I didn't want to ding up the floors any more than I had to, so I just took it real careful when I got to the bottom, because there's going to be one more screw or nail down close, low to the floor. Just make sure that when you get through that, you don't just slam home and run into the floor in the bottom. Once the door is free, you can just grab it by the hinge and the handle or whatever you can get your hands on and lift the door free of that space and take it out and get rid of it. Now, if your floors were in good shape, it'd be pretty easy to just throw another door right back in here right now. But because we're getting the floors refinished, I'm going to leave the doors out until after the floors are finished so that I cover up any space that he couldn't get right next to the wall with the jamb of the door. So next we're gonna move into the hallway and rip out the two built-in closets that are there. One of them has three huge drawers starting at the ground and going up to about halfway, and then above that is just kind of a cabinet with shelves in it. And then the other one is just two big cabinet doors with shelves built in from the bottom up. Now, I know demolition isn't all that interesting to people unless there's a pretty drastic change. Who really cares, right? But I'm kind of planning on showing more of this than I otherwise would have, because I wanted to show you how seriously built these were. So for the last 4 years, I've been working on this house, and at this point, we have done everything, top to bottom, T to B, except for the kitchen. We've kind of been saving that for last, because it's so weird that we don't really know what we want to do with it. But in that 4 years, I have been undoing the work that somebody did years ago. Near as I can tell, based on the shag carpet that I've been finding hidden around, the last time this was really updated was in the 70s. And I have been cursing out that homeowner for having worked so hard to do everything the wrong way, to do everything the hard way. If you watch this demolition, you can see that there's 3-inch finish nails every 3 to 4 inches. He just overbuilt everything. And for the longest time, I've kind of been mad at the guy because I have to go through and undo it and clean up after him. But I've kind of been changing my tune lately. Clearly, he wasn't like a professional builder. Clearly, he did it himself, which is what I'm doing, which is what all of us are kind of trying to do. So now I can kind of appreciate the fact that he didn't know what he was doing, but he was brave enough to go in and do it anyway. So even though it's overbuilt and it's ugly for this day and age, He went in by himself and built it exactly the way he wanted it. And you have to appreciate that kind of motivation and that kind of ability to just undertake a project like this. So I'm still going to curse out the guy every time I have to undo something that's way overbuilt, because you'll see in this closet, it takes a lot of steps to take out a very little amount of stuff without just destroying the house. But he put in the time, he put in the effort, and he got what he wanted out of it. So good for him, I guess. I don't know how many of you have undertaken demolition of something as simple as a little closet or a whole wall or who knows what. But it's funny to me, every time I've done it, you start out very surgical. You get a hammer and you get a pry bar and you try to take things out piece by piece without really messing up much stuff. It's like you want to preserve the junk that you're taking out for some reason. But the longer it takes and the harder the job is, the more you get sledgehammer happy. And by the end, you're not trying to preserve anything. You're not trying to be delicate. You just go hack and slash and just break it out of there because you're exhausted, you're dirty, you're angry. You just want to get to that blank slate so you can start building again. And that's exactly what happened here. Pull off this face frame, pull off this door, unscrew these screws. By the end, it's just, give me a saw and a hammer and let's destroy. So now we're getting to the bottom of this closet space, and you can see that there's actually no floor in the bottom of it, which means that this space has been configured this way ever since the house was built in 1952. So I don't think this is the original built-in closet, but there has been some kind of built-in fixture here since the start. And because of that, we've got to get it all cleaned out so we can get floor put into it, because we're just going to put in a regular sized closet door for this whole space. And there you can see that there's a 2x4 separating the hardwood floor in the hallway and the open, unfinished floor of that closet space. So I'm gonna have to cut that 2x4 out also. Now switching to the other side of the hallway, you can see I'm using an oscillating multi-tool to cut through that 2x4 flush with the studs on either side. That way the walls are still supported the way they need to be, but I can get that barrier that's blocking the hard wood and that open space. So when the floor guy comes in, he can just patch in flush with the hallway and build into that closet. And having a multi-tool like this makes it really, really easy to do. Again, you could use your reciprocating saw, but you're going to end up digging into your hardwood floors a little bit and a little bit into that subfloor to do it. So this is a more surgical way to cut this stud out, and there's really no cleaning up an edge afterwards. You just cut it down and you're good to go. So here's a quick walkthrough of our upstairs without any of our stuff in it. We drug all of our belongings out into the garage to be stored, or what little stuff we needed for the time being went down into the basement with us, where the four of us lived for about a month and a half. So you can see here where all of the walls have been torn out and there's holes left in that hardwood floor. Or here in the dining room, we had to peel up a carpet that was actually glued down. So there's a nasty surface that needs to be cleaned up. Then into the closets, you can see the no floor that's in there. Now the master bedroom actually doesn't have anything to patch, which you'd think, okay, well maybe you could segment that off and not have to refinish it, but for some reason, it had the worst finish on the floor. It's not a high traffic area. I can't figure out what went wrong with it. But there are some spots where it looks like somebody actually dumped bleach on the floor. It's just patchy, splotchy, nasty, so all of it's gotta get finished. And now here when we move into the boys' room, you can actually see a hole in the floor where when we moved into the house, there was a wood-burning stove in the basement and the chimney ran up through the floor in their closet. So that's gonna be one more spot that needs to get patched in this process. And then there is our ugly, ugly fireplace that Katie actually whitewashed in one of the last videos. So if you wanna see how that went from ugly old stone to a more modern look, I'll leave a link for that right here. You can check that out. Now the flooring process, I wasn't actually involved in at all. Like I said, we hired somebody to do it, and every day I'd go to work, and when I'd come home, he'd already be gone, and something would be different about the floors. So to show you this process is going to be more of a series of after shots with me trying to explain what had happened that day without me actually having been there to witness it. So at the end of the second day, he had already come in and patched all of the holes in the floors. You could see right there that he had a new floor grate in where there was a vent coming through. Back when we tore the original wall out of that spot, the vent was actually way up high in the wall, and we had to come up with a way to still get heat into the living room, so we just put a floor vent into the ground, and he blended that in seamlessly. And then he also went through and sanded the old finish off of everything. So now the whole floor was smooth and flat and patched in and just looking fantastic. This is just the raw look of the red oak flooring that was in there. So we used a bunch of plastic sheeting to completely seal off our kitchen and our stairway to try to mitigate the dust getting throughout the rest of the house. I also went through and stuffed old rags into all of the return vents in the house so that if the furnace kicked on, it wouldn't suck dust into them and then blow it throughout the basement as well. So the next step is to fill in all of the cracks with wood filler, and the easiest way to do that is to take a fairly liquid wood filler and just dump it out on the floor and run it around with a squeegee so it just sits on top and then flows into all of the cracks. And then you leave that for a day and it hardens up, and then you can go back over the top of it and sand that all back off. And now you have a perfectly smooth, flat surface free of any of those cracks. So from this point on, we weren't allowed in the upstairs to look at the progress because it was time to apply the finish. The process basically went, day one, apply the stain, which we went with a fairly natural color. We actually went with fruit wood, which was just 1 degree off of natural bare wood. And then the next 3 days were subsequent coats of a clear top coat to protect the wood itself. So for 4 to 5 days, we weren't allowed to go on there. And for 2 more days, it was don't set anything heavy, don't put anything permanent on there. So it was about 4 to 6 or 7 days that we couldn't really be upstairs, and we definitely couldn't be moving back into the upstairs. So from the wood filler stage to the finished stage, I didn't get you any footage, but here's a pretty good after shot of what the floor actually looks like, all finished, all said and done. You ready?
Yeah.
Go. All right, this is where we're gonna cut this one off. In the next video, I'm going to show painting the doors and the trim and then bringing it into the house and putting it all in place and finishing this thing up. And I can't wait to be all done with it because I feel like this is all I've done for about 2 months. It's been a good learning experience. Even though I've done some of it before, I've definitely gotten better at it after this. And the before and after of this project is gonna be pretty remarkable. So I'm proud of it and I'm tired of it. So thank you for watching. Please come back next week to see the finished product. And after that, we're actually gonna get back out into the shop and doing some more of the fun stuff that we all like to do. So thanks, guys. We'll see you next time.